Happy Monday and welcome to Collider TV Talk, TV Talk for TV fans. I'm your host, Sinéad Vries, and this is our weekly show where we talk about all the things happening in the world of television, plus the week that was in TV. Joining us, as always, is Josh Macuga.
What's up, Collider TV Talk fans? We are coming in hot today with an unbelievable episode. We have a special guest co-host. So much to talk about. Sinéad, introduce the rest of the panel here.
Yes, coming in hot, it's David Griffin.
Coming in hot and rocking the Toronto Blue Jays because Josh Donaldson is going to be on the second half of season four of Vikings. So look for, if you're a baseball fan, look for him on Vikings.
And also joining us today, special guest, John Rocha.
Hey, everybody. I'm going to do my best Sasha Pearl Raver imitation. I'm going to rasp up my voice, and I'm going to verbally slay some fools and pick a fight with somebody on the internet. That just seems to be what I need to do sitting in the chair. I feel that vibe.
You feel it.
But I'm happy to be on. This is great.
We're excited to have you there, thank John. You. You know, a personal favorite of all the fans. I hate you.
Yes,
but
losing does that to you.
Yeah, if you guys want to watch this week's Showdown, you know, me and John Rocha here had a very heated match. It went all the way down to the final question, which John won this time as a change to his first
shut
match.
Your mouth
at the expense of me, but that's true. Another story for another day. Sinéad, let's get into it.
Last week, Showtime announced they'd be ordering 20 episodes of the limited series Purity, starring Bond himself, Daniel Craig, in what executives are calling a prestige package. This news could be the final nail in the coffin for Craig as James Bond, which his wrists are pretty happy about. Purity, an adaptation of the Jonathan Franzen novel of the same name, will have In the Bedroom and Little Children filmmaker Todd Field writing and executive producing and directing every episode, while Scott Rudin, Eli Bush, David Hare, and Franzen himself will be executive producers on the series. Franzen and Hare will also be pitching in as writers. Purity is described as a morally complex story of youthful idealism, extreme loyalty, and cold-blooded murder. From Stasi offspring to Oakland anarchists and landscapes as varied as East Berlin, the Bolivian jungle, East Harlem walk-ups, and the California redwoods, Purity is at once supremely ambitious in scope and intensely intimate in its treatment of character, a decade-spanning tragicomedy that builds to a contemporary climax. Whew, it's a lot of words. Josh, is this prestige package with Daniel Craig Showtime's next big project?
Well, I'm sorry for all those words, Sinéad.
It's all right,
I didn't write that. I just, you know, that was what they gave us over there at Showtime. You know, Daniel Craig isn't going to be Bond. We know this. It's like the worst kept secret in Hollywood. They just haven't confirmed that he's definitely not going to be Bond, and that we don't know if it's going to be Tom Hiddleston, Idris Elba, I mean, Emilia Clarke. Who knows who's going to take over the James Bond franchise? I will say that Showtime has kind of knocked it out of the park as of late. I love Billions. I've said it on this show. I know not many people were watching Billions. I love Shameless. Homeland, we'll get into that later in this episode of TV Talk. Showtime does this right. What really gets me excited is it's only 20 episodes. We're only going to see 20 episodes. They don't have to drag this out over 9 seasons. Like, crap, we killed the main character. Three seasons in, we got to think of a new show, but call it the same thing. Plus, Daniel Craig is back doing something that's a little bit less James Bondy, if you will. You know, if you loved him from Layer Cake, or you know, some of the stuff, you know, that he's famous for in England that he was before. No, because when he was named Bond, people outside of that circle of like people like us that have seen everything had no idea who Daniel Craig was. My mom was like, that doesn't look like James Bond. You know what I mean? So for the common person, but now that he's known as James Bond, he can kind of take a step back and do this. For Showtime to bring on these huge names and do a 20 episodes over 2 seasons, man, I can't wait for this. This is going to be incredible, Dave.
I think it's going to be great too because of the shared vision. Every time I see one director, even a pair of directors teaming up and doing every single episode, like Steven Soderbergh in The Nick or something like that, or Cary Fukunaga in season one of True Detective, it just always just kind of just puts me at ease. I know we're going to have a good experience, and this cast is incredible. And I love the description. I have no idea what this is about, even from Sinead's wonderful reading from Showtime there. I have no idea Sinéad what this is going to be.
Oh,
yeah, this is great, great. So that even gets me more excited about it because it seems interesting. Decades spanning. It's going to be globetrotting. We're going all over the world here. I mean, this is something that I hope that I can dive into. I hope it works. Of course, we won't know how it is until we see it on screen, but I'm excited to this.
You know, you mentioned real quick, like Cary Fukunaga, a guy like Michael Hurst, who's written every episode of Vikings, gives you that clear vision towards a thing where it's sort of like, you know, when you watch Sopranos and you saw every episode, the same names under the written by kind of thing, even if it was different directors here and there, it's great. John, what do you think about
this? Yeah, I agree. This is a great point. You both of you are making fantastic points. Yeah, it's one singular vision that's really important. You mentioned Sopranos, David Chase, same thing. Like one singular vision, it's everything was passed through him, and that's how it's supposed to work. And that's how a successful show like this works. The fact it's limited to 2 seasons is fantastic. Mm-hmm. The fact that we have Todd Field, who I am personally one of the in the bedroom, and little children are one of the most fantastic, small, independent, mess with your head films that you will ever watch. Mm-hmm. One is a vengeance film, and one is a film about how to deal with a failing marriage. You know, it's just fantastic how it goes deep into the. So we're gonna see a lot of character work, a lot of levels being explored here as human beings. And it's surprising to me that Daniel Craig, though, has decided to do this. He's a superstar off James Bond. Why go to TV? Why go to a smaller situation? And you know why? Because you're right, Josh. Showtime takes care of their actors. Mm-hmm. They create good stuff. They create good writing, good plots. You've got Billions was fantastic. Yeah. You had two really great actors in Damian Lewis and Paul Giamatti on that. Ray Donovan, Liev Schreiber's fantastic
in that.
And those are so great stuff. And so they do good service to the actors that come on their shows. And I think this is not going to be anything different.
I was gonna say, I feel like Showtime's always been like HBO's little brother. Like, they haven't quite gotten to that level. I mean, Homeland had a lot of critical acclaim, and then it kind of fell apart. Now it's kind of built itself back
last
up.
Last season of Homeland was my favorite.
Yeah, it built itself back up to a better series. So I hope that maybe this will catapult them to that next level. Showtime does put out some great series, but they've never, when paired next to HBO, I feel like HBO's always been a little bit ahead of them, and I think this could do it.
But I think, and we've talked about this last couple weeks on TV Talk, that HBO has kind of, you know, missed. They've been up to bat.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They're swinging at bad pitches, I think. And, you know, besides Game of Thrones, obviously, guys, I'm not talking about Game of Thrones. Don't crucify me on the internet. Okay. But what I'm saying is that Vinyl was a miss. Yeah, I know David loved it.
Yeah.
Vinyl was a miss. Outside of the comedy realm, HBO's had some real misses. Right. And I personally think, I know we talked about last week and everybody's excited for Westworld. And this is something that HBO hasn't done yet, and we should be excited. I'm not like crazy amped on this Westworld thing. So the fact that Showtime is coming in with some of these huge prestige projects, if you will, gets me really excited, and that Showtime is sort of kind of taking the sword away from HBO.
You make a great point, Josh, because just to pick up on the baseball reference and the hat that you're wearing, it's true. It's the Showtime's like the Tampa Bay Rays under Joel Maddon. They were always there at the end. They were doing good work. They got in contention for the playoffs all the time. They didn't win the title. HBO's the Yankees. But because they have these big superstar shows, like super stratus shows, they don't have the same kind of track record as Showtime does. Yeah. But Showtime is consistently knocking out of the park with their work, and so they're building a good credibility with the TV fan base.
Showtime starts
wants
well.
To see it and Starz,
Dexter started great. Yeah. It began in a great way.
Right,
kind of fizzled out. Homeland started strong.
Yeah,
fizzled out. Got stronger,
we'll
got better.
Yeah.
We're gonna get there later. Yeah. But you know, so I'm hoping that they can keep the momentum going with this series.
Some long distance runners.
Yeah, and I need to audition for this, because if it's gonna be the Bolivian jungles, as a son of Bolivian immigrants, I want to be in the show.
We got the Bolivian Sasha Pro.
Hire him. Showtime. Hire
him. All right, Sinéad, what's next?
In series order news, HBO ordered the Bill Hader vehicle Barry to series. Barry, played by Hader, is an ex-Marine turned hitman who goes to L.A. for a job and gets in with the local theater troupe, and we're guessing hijinks ensues in what producers are calling Gross Point Blank meets Waiting for Guffman. On the other side of the premium fence, Julie Andrews and Netflix are teaming up with the Jim Henson Company to make Julie's Greenroom, the most ambitious bit of children's programming on the streaming service. Andrews will teach puppets fresh into the theater scene, known as greenies, and over the course of the season produce a stage play with improv, music, etc. David, which program about quote-unquote show business makes more of a splash?
Oh, splash. I don't know. I mean, I feel like the Bill Hader is probably the bigger story, but I like Jim Henson, the Jim Henson Company. The last Jim Henson Company show that I saw produced was a show called Farscape on Sci-Fi. Came out like 99 to 2002, which was a really underrated sci-fi show. Josh, you know I love my sci-fi shows.
Yeah.
You know, my sci-fi and my British shows. So,
you guys are keeping track at home. That's the 97th time David has mentioned sci-fi on TV.
I'm trying to get some love. So I'm excited to see what the Jim Henson Company is going to do, because I think they usually make some special projects, take a lot of love and care with what they do, and Julie Andrews teaming up with that. I think that's going to be something to see. But I feel like the Bill Hader's probably splash is probably the bigger story, I would think.
Is Daniel Day-Kim in Babylon 5 or in Farscape? Which one was he in?
No, I'm not a Babylon 5 guy.
Okay, so maybe
he wasn't in. Yeah, no, he wasn't
okay,
in
so
Farscape.
Maybe he was in Babylon 5.
I know we usually have a spoiler alert thing up there, but can we put nerd alert up there?
Nerd alert. So
what are you trying to say? I love what you're saying here. It's fantastic stuff with Barry. I think that's the interesting thing because it's hater. It's against type. You mm-hmm. don't think a guy like that's going to play a Marine, yeah. a hitman, or an assassin rather, you know, a sharpshooter, all this, and then turn him into this thing where he's working on improv, which leads to me like there's going to be more humor there. That seems more accessible humor. I think Julie Andrews' show is more of a niche type show, yeah. not necessarily one that's going to appeal mainstream. We saw the Muppets already get canceled yeah. by ABC, unfortunately. This feels like a little bit of that, but I think most, I wonder what it's like for the viewer to watch something like this, because to me, I'll probably watch both of those shows and have visceral reactions to them because I'm an actor, because I've been through these kinds of things in these experiences. Mm. But I wonder how, like, you know, Joe Blow at home or Mary Blow at home will watch this and be like, is this something that I really want to get into? And I feel like Barry's more of a wider spectrum than the Julie Andrews
show. I think one of the things that mm-hmm. we're missing maybe in this story is that ABC brought on the Muppets to an adult audience, right? So you're talking about people from our generation, a little bit older. Mm-hmm. Obviously, people that watch network TV skew a little bit older. And they were looking for that nostalgia audience for mm-hmm. Muppets. Mm-hmm. But in reality, what they did was they created a children's show for adults. And the adults were like, I don't watch this anymore. Like, this is reminding me of my childhood and I would take my kids to see this or something. But my kids aren't watching primetime network TV. Yeah. So what Netflix is doing is giving Julie Andrews the thought of like, okay, maybe like let's reboot a little bit of a franchise. It doesn't have to be exactly the Muppets, but let me reboot a little bit of franchise, a little bit of nostalgia, and give kids streaming service to something. Because outside of like Paw Patrol, because I've got nieces and nephews, outside of like Paw Patrol and Bubble Guppies, Netflix really doesn't have a crap ton of children programming. Mm-hmm. You have a lot of this stuff from other TV channels, but Netflix themselves doesn't have mm-hmm. original children's programming. So the fact that they're getting into that is a pretty awesome thing. Again, in Netflix's ultimate goal to take over the world.
They're following Amazon because Amazon has been developing yes. children shows. Mm-hmm. They do yeah. the original children's program. And even because you think about HBO, they don't have, I mean, what were we kids? We watched Babar. Yeah. Remember the elephant?
Yeah.
The animated elephant. I don't even know if that was even their show. I don't know if that was like an import.
I loved
I mean,
Arthur. Do you guys remember?
Yeah. Arthur? Oh, yeah. Yeah. Arthur, yeah.
Arthur, yeah. Arthur was mm-hmm. a good one. Now, on the flip, the Bill Hader thing, I think that they've been trying to shove Bill Hader into being a movie star for a while.
Yes.
And I think that he's a great supporting guy. I think he's great best friend. I think he's great. He's.
I love him in Trainwreck.
Okay. In Trainwreck, again, he's a great like yeah. supporting guy. He Schumer, really fed yeah. off LeBron James, and I think Amy Schumer was more of the movie star in that movie. The yeah. fact that he's going to TV, and like you said in the thing, what really interests me about this plot is that nobody ever thinks of the LA theater scene because there really isn't one.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah. And there's a lot of weirdos that are in theater out here. They're like, there's just, it's just a weird thing. The theater scene, unlike New York, it's yeah. just different.
Yeah.
New York, everybody's like, I'm in theater, and everybody respects. In LA, it's theater. They're like, oh, it was like a one-man show about hot dog buns. Like, nobody really
I saw that one actually.
It was good. It was really good. So the fact that they're kind of in investigating this goes on the fact that there are a lot of us that live out here in entertainment who have had to go see their buddy's one-man show at the Complex Black Box Theater for 50 people. Yeah. You know, so I like that they're gonna go into this because there is so much comedy that you can pull out of a weird, struggling theater scene in LA. Sinead, what's next?
In cancellation and renewal news, Showtime has delayed production on Homeland, but will debut the newest season sometime in the winter of 2017. And according to The Hollywood Reporter, negotiations for two more seasons are in the works. Starz has ordered two more seasons of Outlander, which is rare for the premium channel, and Unreal on Lifetime has already been upped for a third season before the second season has aired. John, is three more total seasons of Homeland too many?
I gotta be honest with you. I would think it's too many. Like to me, I two seasons was more than enough, in my opinion. And I know they brought in F. Murray Abraham, who I'm a massive fan of, and he brought a great element to the show. Mandy Patinkin always on point, yeah. and with Claire, obviously Claire Danes carrying the show. There's a lot of good actors on the show, but there's plot lines that they conveniently get. You know, oh, I had a baby. Oh, this whole thing. It's just to me, it's a little. It's not as strong of a show as I would like it to have been, and to me, some of the believability factors have an issue with me. So if you're going to extend it for three seasons, what are you going to do with the story? How deep are we going into the ISIS stuff? How deep are we going into her exploration of the national security stuff? Mm-hmm. And how deep are we going into her psychosis that's still around, no matter how many medications? That's got to pop itself back up as a plotline, as a storyline, because that's the signifying character trait, other than the whole body cry of Claire Danes, yeah. that you see on the show.
So you don't want to see more of Claire Danes crying? The crying face? You don't see that? I mean,
she's the best. She's the best.
She's the best crier on television.
She's the best.
She's the best. That's true. It's believable.
Yeah, I buy it.
As soon as she starts talking to somebody, I don't care if she walks into a Chuck E. Cheese and freaks out that she doesn't have enough tokens. She is crying. They're behind that thing. Her eyes are already tearing up, and she's like, "Oh my God, it's gonna work."
It's always the cough and then the avalanche.
Yeah. Because last season of Homeland, I thought was fantastic, but it was a one-off. It felt like a one-off.
Mm.
And I really feel like they should, if they're going to do this three more seasons, just tell us that they're going to be one-off seasons.
Yeah. That might work. Absolutely, John.
Have like a villain of the season.
Yes. Big bad.
That totally works.
Yeah.
Yeah. That I would accept.
Because I know you wanted to put more seasons of Homeland in highs and lows. You wanted to put it in the lows.
Well, I noticed that this paragraph here, I saw Outlanders mentioned. If you look behind Mr. Rocha's head there.
Massive head.
You see the lovely Catriona Belfay, the lovely Irish actress who is in Homeland. She's got renewed for two more seasons, which is going to be based off of the next two books in the series. Season one was off the first book, season two, the second, and we're going to get the next two. This series continues to be one of the best on
television.
No, don't have to read. Remember, you put down the book and you pick up the remote. So put down that book, pick up the remote, and watch the first season of Outlander. I know Adam here in the studio has been watching it. I know he's loving it. It's a really good story. It's one you can watch. You know, ladies and gentlemen will both like it. You know, there's romance, intrigue, betrayal.
This is
David Picks, right? We're under David Picks. Let's talk more about Outlander. No, I already did that. I'm not going to rant about that, but I am very happy to see that it was renewed.
Yeah, because Starz is famous for like two seasons, right? Out, Boss, two seasons gone. Magic City, two seasons
Spartacus was their biggest hit.
Yeah.
Until Outlander. Outlander premiered it was their highest rated premiere ever.
It's a good show.
For season two.
It's a good show.
It's brought back more people the second time. Yeah.
If you're into the period stuff, like Downton Abbey, that kind of stuff, going backwards in time, it's a fun show to enjoy and see when she's battling between the two worlds and the guy who from Game of Thrones who's playing Ed Mirror,
Tobias Menzies.
Yeah, Tobias Menzies is in this. Yeah. It's a good show. But shout out to Unreal.
And she's really improved. I mean, she's a former model. I think she's like a Dolce & Gabbana model, you know, a very pretty woman, but I wasn't sure how she was going to do as an actor.
Yeah.
But each episode, each season, she's getting better and better.
Well, she's great in Money Monster. She's fantastic
in Money Monster. I haven't seen that. That's right. It's George Clooney.
She's so good.
I will say Unreal. I know that Sinéad, you don't watch this show, but you should, because it's about your favorite thing, which is like Bachelor and Bachelorette and the behind the scenes of what it takes to be in a reality show and like a producer thing of it. The fact that they got a third season is great, because Lifetime, when you hear Lifetime, all you think about is like the true story of JonBenet Ramsey, or like my husband
kidnapped
is the worst.
At 17.
Yeah, kidnapped. Yeah, correct. So the fact that they're getting into some more gritty and real and funny and actually like respectable programming, and the fact that they renew this for a third season before the second season comes on says a lot about the network. I think we might have to start thinking about Lifetime as a player eventually. And you should watch Unreal, because you will love it.
Will.
Now that the path is over, you have something you can watch. Right,
thanks.
Shay? Yeah, you're welcome. All right, guys, before we go on, we had the distinct pleasure of having the showrunners for Voltron Legendary Defender come into studio and talk with David and myself. The series debuts this Friday, June 10th, on Netflix. It's a 13-episode order. We will do a series review. Some of the Clatter TV Talk regulars here, maybe Dennis Sen, we'll figure it out. We're going to do a series review, but the full interview with Lauren Montgomery and Joaquim Dos Santos is on the Clatter Video YouTube channel. It's under the TV Talk playlist. We're going to show you guys a 2-minute snippet here right now, but again, the full interview is up right now, so go check that out. And thank you, DreamWorks and Voltron, for coming in and talking to us. Up, what were some of your animated inspirations to even get into this industry? Because I'm sure there's a lot of people that watch our show, that watch a lot of shows. How does one get into the animation world?
Yeah,
right?
I mean, I think Lauren and I have two very different stories about how two very different avenues about how we got in. But I think growing up for me, shows, you know, like Voltron, Robotech was immense for both of us.
Really?
That was a big one. I mean, all those shows that were geared towards kids of a certain age in the 80s, G.I. Joe, Thundercats, all those shows, you know. And what you didn't realize at the time was so many of those shows were being produced, you know, kind of co-produced, or they were acquisitions from Japan, like Voltron.
Yeah.
So you sort of had this influx of this anime influence without realizing you were getting it.
Yeah.
A lot of the time. But yeah, I mean, that was a huge influence.
Lauren, for you?
Yeah, very similar. I also had
many Disney movies that I love. Like, I was huge on Disney princesses. Little Mermaid is my favorite movie of all time.
Sure.
But, you know, that was kind of like my doorway in as a child watching like these Disney movies. And then, you know, I was just a huge fan of animation. I watched a ton of the WB stuff, like the Tiny Toons and the Animaniacs. And then Batman the Animated Series came out.
That was a game
changer.
It
blew my mind.
Yeah.
And Robotech was huge. And then, like, anime started becoming a thing that was much more easily accessible. Like, there was a long period of time where it was really hard to find. You kind of had to either know what channel to find it on. It was on Sci-Fi at like 4 a.m. Yeah. maybe, or you'd have to go to whatever video store and pay $40 for a copy of Ghost in the Shell.
There's a place local to here, Odyssey Video, that I'd rent the same five anime films. It was like like Wicked City, Appleseed, Akira, over and over and over again, because that was your only connection to it.
All right, guys, special thanks to Lauren Montgomery and Joaquin Dos Santos from Voltron Legendary Defender. Again, this Friday on Netflix. What, did I mess up again?
You were fantastic. No, you were just fantastic. Such a good intro. You came in hot, man.
Basically, at this point, all I'm doing is trying to get on that blooper reel at the end of the Best Of in Collider Talk. If you guys don't watch that Best Of on Collider, it's absolutely fantastic. Again, thank you, guys. Thank you to DreamWorks and Joaquin and Lauren for coming in and talking to us. I'm really excited for Voltron. So, guys, check that out, and we will put up a series review with some of the personalities over here at Collider talking about it. Until then, Sinead, superhero rundown. It's the time. You guys know what it's all about. Superhero TV news. Sinead, what's first?
Thanks to a Variety report this morning, it's official. Superman will join Supergirl in season 2, now on the CW. In a statement from executive producer Andrew Kreisberg on behalf of the production team, he said, "Greg, Allie, and I are beyond thrilled to welcome Clark Kent and his slightly more famous alter ego to the world of Supergirl. Superman will be appearing in the first 2 episodes of the new season, and we cannot wait to see who next dons the red cape." David, should they just call Tom Welling?
No, I mean, I know everybody wants it. I know Smallville fans want it. I've seen the GIFs. I've seen the tweets. Everybody wants Tom Welling. I have nothing against Tom Welling. I like Tom Welling.
Oh, you don't?
No, he seems like a great guy.
Yeah.
Is he? I don't know.
Time before the show.
Nothing against Tom Welling.
You guys don't see this. Before the cameras start rolling, all we hear is David just crushing Tom Welling.
That's a lie. Don't believe it. That's a lie. I don't think we need somebody new. This is a new show. This is the new CW. This is not Smallville CW, even though sometimes we watch Arrow and sometimes it feels like, you know, feels like the old CW. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But I'm hoping that they get a somebody new. But, you know, Tom Welling could work. Because
what's he up to these days?
Well, I know he does like some directing and
I don't know, sitting on that pile of money.
You know,
he did 10 seasons. He got syndication money.
That Nicholas Sparks movie with the girl.
Me Before You?
No, that's the new one. It was the other one. The Choice.
Oh, was he in The Choice?
He was in The Choice.
Wow. He was also in Cheaper by the Dozen 1 and 2.
That's right. Yeah. That's right.
I was going to say real quick, they could do him because, remember, the Superman has been established. He's been around for a while. He's a little bit older. Mm-hmm. So they could use Tom Welling.
Right. Sure.
You calling him old, too?
No.
So much hate for Tom Welling.
No, he's a very handsome man.
Griffin.
Handsome man? No.
My goodness.
Oh, yikes. Man.
Okay, well, maybe here's the question. Who would you like to see play the Superman?
Denzel. Denzel Washington. Get Denzel. No, I'm joking.
I gotta get out of here.
Yeah, that's tough.
Yeah,
I don't know. We get one of their CW alums, like maybe get Ian Somerhalder or something. Ooh, you know, I don't know if that would work.
Rocha.
I can't think of the actor's name, but he was in The Nice Guys. He played the John Boy character.
Okay,
I think he'd be a great Superman.
Yeah.
Nice chiseled face, good hair, great shape.
Oh, no, he is Superman. That's Matt Bomer.
Yeah, Matt Bomer.
Yeah, Matt Bomer.
I like
he looks like, if you type in Matt Bomer, he looks like Clark Kent.
Yeah, that's
he
what I'm saying.
Yeah, he was in Magic Mike.
I think he's a fantastic actor. Because he's up and coming, and I imagine Superman's not going to be the prevalent thing in season 2 because you still have to establish Kara a little bit more. You don't want her to be the damsel in distress. That would just piss off so much stuff that they've already established about her. She has to be her own heroine, or her own hero rather, and she has to figure things out, and she'll like reach out to Superman, so maybe he'll be more involved because it'll maybe bring some more of those characters from that universe, some more of the villains, so that'd be great. But you don't want to have Superman constantly be bailing her out. That's just not going to work. So I think it works for Bomber because Bomber's got a bunch of projects in the works. So it wouldn't be bad for him to occasionally recur as Superman.
He does look like Clark Kent. Move. He does.
Yeah. Tom Welling, I love Tom Welling. Tom Smallville was a bit tough to swallow with the villain of the week stuff. But Tom did a great job. And he was real earnest and believable as Superman. And it would be great to have him back, I guess. But he's older now. Who knows what his look would be. Yeah. But I think you want to go, like you said, David, it's a new CW, new show. Bomber's the nice choice.
Mm-hmm. Sinead, you're up on like the hot teen dudes of the day, or like the hot dudes of the day. Who do you think?
Who's a hot dude?
Yeah, who's a super hot dude?
I mean, there's so many. I think Matt Bomer is a great choice. Cool. Because he's super hot. Ian Somerhalder would be good too, because he's also fresh off of Vampire Diaries. Mm-hmm. He's got a lot of people like rooting for him to get that next big role. But is this going to be a next big role? Is this going to be more of like a cameo?
Yeah, it's a recurring.
Because if it's a cameo, I almost feel like it needs to be someone even lesser than Matt Bomer, even newer. Because I agree with you. I think that they need to really build Supergirl to be her own hero so people can really get on board with her story. And this whole CW taking on the show, it's finally time for Supergirl to like kick some ass. So I feel like Superman shouldn't be someone that we're all so excited to see.
I think we can all agree that all the girls in the office on the day of casting for the new Superman are going to be hanging around the water cooler. It's like the hottest dude, the young dudes in Hollywood coming in. I don't know if I have like a preference. I will say that I would like to see more Superman in the CW universe if they introduce him in Supergirl and they keep. I know he's really expensive, so bringing him in is kind of expensive, but. If you do cast this well, then you're looking at another an awesome addition to that CW family and the CW universe they're now creating, which leads us into our third story after this next one about kind of like what they're doing in CW.
It's their Justice League. Yeah. It's what their equivalent, what they're going to have.
Justice Society, which they kind of
four part crossovers now.
Well, what Sinead said is a great point, because Teddy Sears was kind of not that well known, and then he is playing the pseudo Jay Garrick and Zoom, right? So you bring him in. He did a nice job with that part on The Flash, and so they have a good track record of picking older actors or actors that are just a little bit older than their leads to kind of guide them through situations. So you're right, they may pick someone that's not that well known but can still come in and do a nice job in the recurring role.
Absolutely. Sinead, what's next?
In more news from FX's Legion, it appears the show may not exist exactly in the X-Men movie universe. Coming from an interview with Hit Fix, showrunner and Noah Hawley said about who comic book fans know as Charles Xavier's son, "It's a little more of a fable in my mind. If you were to say, where is it and when is it, it's not exactly clear. I think the recent X-Men movies, starting with First Class, are rooted in a time period and a world and playing with history in interesting ways. This isn't doing that. John, will making Legion outside of the X-Men movie universe give Legion a larger scope to work with, or should they be dealing in a timeline created by the movies?"
No, I think we've seen this with studios separating the TV universe from the movie universe. They want to establish their own thing, and if they can make them connect it down the road, that's fine. I think you've got to create your own universe, your own timeline within your show. Fans are going to be dedicated to your show. They may not enjoy the X-Men universe, especially the last film. Not a lot of people. It's pretty 50-50 on that. So you want to just kind of take a step and create your own universe, get people involved. That we were just talking about Supergirl, same thing. Supergirl has her own separate universe. Jimmy Olsen's black, his name is James, he's got this other best friend. So you create the whole universe of stuff that I forget the actress, I'm blanking now with
Supergirl,
the girl, the boss in Supergirl, the actress.
Oh, Calista Flockhart.
Yeah, Calista Flockhart. What she set up, Cat Stark. So what you have here with this Legion is such an interesting character because of how he was created. Charles Xavier slept with a female professor or scientist, and because they were using his mind control stuff to help people recover from the Holocaust, and so he had an affair with this woman. They had a baby. That's what he's born from, Legion. But he has a lot. He has the what do you call it? We see visions and hears voices. And he doesn't know what's true and what isn't. So he's a big time anti-hero in the X-Men universe.
And
so,
they say he's like schizophrenic.
Yeah,
basically.
Schizophrenic.
But he realizes when he finds that the visions that he's seeing are actually real,
right?
To a certain extent, which would again drive you crazy.
They've chosen a great guy in Dan Stevens, great actor. If you remember him from Downton Abbey, he was in an awesome film that came out a couple of years ago, where The Visitor, which is awesome. If you haven't seen that, it's a great kind of 80s homage film to those kind of like The Hitcher, those kinds of films. Good actor, good choice. We'll see. With Aubrey Plaza is an interesting choice. So there's a lot here that I think they can create their own universe.
And I always like that when they go away from the movies. We did The Arrow, we did Arrow. Josh did Arrow all season. United the Flash all season, and I've never really saw fans hoping that we'd get more of the movie universe included. I think people would like to see maybe some of the actors show up,
sure,
but nothing to do with the storylines converging. Because I think on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., where it struggled in its first season, even though I've heard it's gotten a lot better, especially from Josh and Michael Medina, is that it tried to stick too close to the movies. And every time like Thor would blow up, mess up London, he's like, we got to go to London and help people fix things up. And I think that's just problematic, whereas this allows them to have more creativity. They can go their own way and create their own vision.
I'm kind of on the fence in the sense of I wouldn't mind if, you know, because we kind of just ended this Singer trilogy or whatever you want to call it with Apocalypse. Now their next movie, they might, you know, obviously the next one is going to be the last Wolverine movie, right?
Yeah, Weapon X.
And then, you know, you got the X-Force or New Mutants or whatever. Mm-hmm. They're kind of they're trending towards this thing. If you go back to like the last in the first part of the trilogy and you're somewhat in like modern times and you reference the movie here and there, but you don't necessarily do exactly what they're doing in the movies or something like that, that would be kind of cool. But this guy seems like he's in a totally different world, mm-hmm, regardless. Mm-hmm. And I like the fact that they're not going to like inundate us with mutants. Like, give us a couple of mutants that we know, a couple of mutants we don't, and you in that TV universe, you can use some of the ones that we haven't seen in the movies, mm-hmm, and ones that we want to see in the movies we haven't. Like, ideally, like Jubilee, this is our first movie in X-Men Apocalypse. But if you watch the X-Men animated series, Jubilee was like the whole series. Yeah. So I'm really and FX does these things really well. So I'm really looking forward to this, and I hope that they're not constricted with the movie.
It's FX. That's my second favorite network below HBO. Right. FX does such a good job with their
shows. Well, Noah Hawley, having done Fargo, you know he can create a fantastic universe to be a part of. Yeah.
All right, Sinead, last thing here in Superhero Rundown.
In a report from TV Line, it appears Arrow is heading back to its gritty, dark roots and introducing a season 5 villain modeled after The Wire's Stringer Bell, infamously played by Idris Elba. The new antagonist, tentatively named Anton Church, who doesn't exist in the DC Comics database for the moment, is described as a ruthless crime lord who will fill the power vacuum left by the dearly departed Damian Dark and duplicitous Mayor Ruvé Adams. The casting description for the role called the character an apex predator who cuts his way through the shadows by taking down the biggest threat first. Josh, does the idea of a Stringer Bell character fit into the CW Arrow model?
Well, I mean, we talked about it. I did the Arrow after show this whole time. And, you know, when you're on that show, you can't be super negative the whole time because then I just look like the asshat of the show. But I will say that this season of Arrow wasn't amazing. It wasn't.
What a shock.
Saying that you're going to model him after Stringer Bell is impossible. Stringer Bell, The Wire is one of the most perfect television shows you'll ever watch. And Stringer Bell was incredible. I know Dennis will vouch for this till the day he dies. He'll get The Wire on his gravestone. But
here lies a man who loved to watch The Wire.
Well, The Wire.
He has that plaque outside of his office. Yeah. If you come at the king, you best not miss.
And Stringer Bell and Idris Elba, I think that, and that show and that character launched Idris Elba into the lexicon of America because he was well known in England. He was already kind of an established actor. He comes over here, he nails this part as a Baltimore crime lord. That is sort of going for, you know, trying to make it legit, mm-hmm, trying to make his businesses legit, and he just couldn't do it because it's impossible once you're, we've learned that multiple movies over. We talked about it on Peaky Blinders. But the fact that they're even trying to go back to a dark, gritty route and not a storyline about a guy, one guy, launching all of the nuclear missiles in the world to end the world as an Arrow storyline just doesn't make sense. It just didn't make sense. It was dumb. And the fact that they're going to go back to like a gritty roots, a crime lord, like season 1 and season 2, which was awesome TV, which sold me on Arrow, it means that they're finally listening to the fans of like, hey, don't do a show about supernatural magicians. Do a show about a guy who wants to take down crime bosses.
Stop making him Batman, too.
Yeah.
Mm. Even Stephen Amell has come out personally. He said this. He said Arrow is basically another version of Batman, not as good as a version of Batman. He said something to that effect. He's acknowledged that the show is, I mean, he fights Batman's villains. I mean, it about Green Arrow. Like, stop being Batman. That's one. I know we're not going to get a standalone Batman series outside of the animated universe because there's a WB so protective of Batman. Yeah. But just make your own show. Be confident in your own show and don't have to compare it to The Wire, to Sopranos, to Game of Thrones. Just make a good show. People want to project that onto your show. Be like, hey, this is kind of reminiscent of The Wire. This is reminiscent of Sopranos. Then let them do that. But you got to be careful if we start, you know, comparing yourself to one of the greatest series of all time. Yeah, it's just kind of getting the shaky ground there.
You're not going to bring Simon to two.
Yeah, it's like, relax.
Well, I guess it's kind of like, you know, you're down. I think a lot of people felt this season wasn't that great.
And I feel like this is kind of bottom of the ninth, down by four run. We're going to down by three run. We're going to try to hit a grand slam. We're going to figure it all out. And the thing, the odds are really high against you getting it, you know? And so I feel like what you said, David, is correct. Bringing in The Wire, even referencing The Wire in connection with Arrow is just, you're so way out there and off base of what you're trying to do. It's a CW show. Mm-hmm. Where it lost its focus this year, and I think half of last year too, last season rather, was this whole melodrama of the relationship. It was so unnecessary. He's a hero. Flash does a really great job with this stuff. And yeah, sometimes they hit the wrong notes with the Iris relationship, but they don't lean into it. And I think what they do with that is storyline, what they do with Grant Gustin and his character in Flash is they get him to those points, but then they have other things come in the way. And that's the way it should be. You know, heroes are, it's a lonely job, and there's a reason for that. And I think if you're going to go back, that's fine. Go back to the first, second season, make it grittier, make it this whole thing. That's great. Don't reference The Wire, because you're not going to do The Wire. And his name, Anton Church, is very reminiscent of Anton Chigurh from No Country for Old Men.
Yeah.
So it's a bit, you've got a lot of things kind of like, well, how original is this? You know, and that's my concern.
And then when you watch the CW, I don't expect to see The Wire. I don't expect to see Outlander. I don't expect to see Vikings when I watch CW. I'm not knocking CW. I watch CW. Mm-hmm. I like shows like The Flash. I like the first six seasons of Supernatural. But I don't need to see HBO like program. If they want to go that direction, more power to them, but CW has a certain mold, they have a certain look, a certain style, and they've done a good job at that recently, and that's fine. Be proud of that.
The originals is great.
Yeah, they do a good job.
I think too with The Wire, and like you said, perfectly said, superheroes are lonely people.
Yeah,
right.
Mm-hmm. It's a lonely job.
The thing that Arrow kept doing, like as season 3 and 4 went on, was like more jumps from 3-story buildings. More, he's a human being, right?
There's that one season where Rookie shot an arrow into the clouds, just kind of went. I'm like, where's he going?
Exactly.
Like, there's no building.
A lot of times he gets like convenience escapes and whatnot. But I think that if you.
That's funny.
Sinead, everybody. I'm with you. Like, don't compare it to The Wire, but if you wanted to get back to that gritty thing, by all means, because he started this team, and all of a sudden they just went in and they were all like Capoeira masters, right? And that's not really what you had in season 1 and 2. Like, it was more of a gritty, I'm going to punch you in the face. Mm-hmm. And that's how I'm going to win this thing. I'm not going to jump off. I'm not going to, like, swing from stuff. Just be the Arrow. You go in, guns blazing, because you're trying to save the city. You're not trying to, like, keep 90 people happy in a green cave that everybody can somehow get into. That's
like Star Labs. No security.
None.
Yeah, it's just CW, there's no security.
Me and my wife were lost. Is this Star Labs? Yes. Oh, cool. All right, guys, we're going to go into some highs and lows of the week. Let's start with highs. Obviously, let's talk some Game of Thrones, because we're each week that goes by, I realize we only have one episode left, or two episodes, you know, like we only have a few episodes left. Preacher, we'll talk, we're doing reviews here. The Americans still crushing it. Gillian Anderson casting New Gods. Vice, I love this week's Vice, and the release of Peaky Blinders. We can talk about that as well. Let's start with Game of Thrones.
Yeah.
John Rocha, one of the hosts of the after show, he took my place because I was tired of getting abused day in and day out. So I threw that on to David, John David Rocha over here. John Stephen Rocha.
John David Rocha.
John David Rocha. JD Rocha. Yeah, that's right. Just call me JD. I enjoyed this episode. It's getting a little bit of negativity online, which I don't understand. I really enjoyed the episode. Did a great job of setting stuff up. Everybody is arming themselves. Everybody is making their moves to get their armies squared away because they know the battle is coming amongst themselves and the White Walkers. So there's a lot of stuff that's happening within the season. And this past episode, you saw these characters, you saw them go to the lower houses of the North, or the smaller houses of the North rather, to see if they can shore up their army. They went to the head thing with the wildlings. You had Arya having a certain experience that I don't want to spoil.
You can throw spoiler alert up.
Really?
Can I?
Yeah, we got a little thing there.
Boom. Okay, there we go. Away, man. Look at that.
I gotta get one of those.
You guys can see the spoiler
just for life. Because we were walking around for life. Spoiler alert, don't walk by me.
Well, my Facebook. all those kinds of things that were happening, and you saw the increasing of the storylines and where we're going, and I'm excited to see. And we had the return of Bronn. We had the return of the Hound. Yeah. So already things are starting to really escalate.
Ian friggin' McShane.
McShane, yeah.
Who, if you guys haven't watched Deadwood, another very slow HBO show, but really
fantastic
well done.
Fantastic show.
I watched it with a buddy last night, and I said that not every episode can be Detroit Rock City, right? You have to in between the action, you have to have a little bit of setup. And in Game of Thrones, the setup is the unification of armies, right? And I loved going to, Bear Island? Is that what it's called?
Yeah, Bear Island.
Bear Island and Lyanna, the little queen.
Lady Lyanna, yeah.
She's saying, we have 62 men. And when she said 62, I was like, oh, it's going to say 62,000. She's like, no, 62. But they fight with out of 10 men. And I'm like, oh, well, okay, so 620 added to the 2,000. All right, let me do a carry thing. But it reminded me, too, if you guys I was a big fan of Roman history. I lived in Rome for a bit, and I studied a ton of Roman history. And there's a very famous battle that is, there's a huge arc when you walk into the Roman Forum, and it depicts the battle when like 300 Jews fought off 10,000 Romans in Rome. And it sometimes, if you watch Vikings, like they go into those battles, it isn't so much how many men you have sometimes, it's how fierce they fight. And I think that's what we're getting to with Game of Thrones, is they're building this small but furious army. I think this episode was a little slow at points. But I loved this episode. I didn't really care about it, because sometimes the dialogue and the setup, and sometimes you need a step back in Game of Thrones to realize what the frig is going on.
Yeah.
Because after each episode, if you guys go to collider.com, they show the map of where people are, and I'm like, okay, so this is here and this is here and this is great. Awesome.
Yeah.
Loved all of that. And for a one-off episode to throw Ian McShane in Game of Thrones, bravo.
Yeah.
Just really well done.
Bravos.
Yeah. Oh,
nailed it.
Nailed it.
Nailed it.
Wow. David D. Griff.
So look at all the highs and lows here. Speaking of Ian McShane,
yes,
he's going to be on American Gods, which is good.
With Jillian, nice.
Which is good news. And Jillian Anderson, who, if you know, I was trying to get an X-Files recap show here, but Dennis kept turning me down.
No, I don't know why. You haven't.
No, I'm just joking.
You didn't know. You guys can watch the David Griffin X-Files recap show.
Yeah, X-Files.
It's here every Tuesday on Collider Video. It's private and unlisted, so you can't really get to it.
It's just a black frame for half an hour. Yeah.
And also, I've been loving Jillian for the last few years, not just because of her X-Files, but because she's in London. She's like, I think she lives in London now. She does all this BBC stuff. She's on a War and Peace remake they did recently.
The Fall
is a great TV show with 50 Shades of Grey star in there and all that. Yeah. I like Gillian Anderson is getting more work. She's a great actress.
I didn't know a ton about this new God, so I started doing a bunch of reading.
It's Neil Gaiman.
Sounds fantastic. We should definitely do some stuff that, man. Yeah. And Starz, they went from like two and out to now they're like letting series breathe and they're finding their footing. Because if you guys ever watched Party Down, that is the most tragically canceled early show ever. It was only two seasons.
Adam Jane Scott.
So good.
Yep.
If you guys want to see perfect comedy episode, go and watch the Steve Guttenberg episode of Party Down. It's unbelievable. New Gods, and now they're adding, like, they just keep adding bigger and bigger casts.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Sinead, what do you see on here that you like? Or is there a high for you this week that we didn't
get? I read the synopsis of New Gods, and it actually made me want to read, which is a big thing for me. I think this
synopsis... Nothing makes me want to read.
No. I think this synopsis is incredible. I think this show looks amazing. I mean, obviously, I'm reading a synopsis of a book, so I don't know much about the show yet, but the story is... seems great. I'm really looking forward to it. This is the kind of thing that gets me excited. I love gods and mythology. I love it. And it just almost seems like it could even have a little bit of comedy to it as well. And like light parts to it. God's trying to like struggle living amongst everyone else and trying to be the bigger God. I mean, it looks awesome. Looks great.
Like Joan Osborne said, what if God was one of us?
Oh, nice.
Just a stranger on the bus trying to make his way home.
Okay. What about Preacher? Have you guys talked about
Preacher? We have a Preacher review. It's going to come out later today. Okay. David and I just did it, so look forward to that. But I'm really on board with Preacher. Yeah. How are you feeling?
I love the pilot. I couldn't get to the second episode last night, but I'm looking forward to it. What they were able to do with Arsface, how they were able to bring all these characters in and make them seamless. And maybe I've only read a couple of issues of Preacher, but I get who the characters are. Mm-hmm. So I was kind of in both camps, not someone who's read a lot of the comic books and not someone who hasn't, understanding. So it was great to watch. It was very engrossing. Yeah. And Dominic Cooper, I mean, you can watch Dominic Cooper all day long. That guy just has great charm, great personality, and it's fantastic acting in the moments, the turns and the switches that he has in the bar scene in the pilot where he goes, all right, hit my limit. Let's get it on. It was like, wow.
Yeah.
This is so good
Smiling
stuff.
Smiling while punching. Just fantastic. We also, guys, did a review of Peaky Blinders Season 3, which was released by Netflix on May 31st. David and I blew through that. It's going to be up on the channel probably tomorrow, the Peaky Blinders Season 3 review. Just real quick. It's one of my favorite shows of all time now.
So good. It's, one of the best gangster shows you're going to see. I mean, if you like Sopranos, you're going to love this. I mean, I got it's three so episodes, well acted. Yeah.
The first season, and then, yeah.
And a lot of people have been tweeting us. I know you guys probably see it. Like, now that a lot of shows are over and we're in the summer season, which can tend to be kind of slow, what shows should I watch? What shows should I binge? What shows should I, like, catch up on? If you guys haven't watched Peaky Blinders, go in and watch that. Vikings, I'm obsessed with now. I'm going to totally catch up with Outlander. I think if you haven't watched Downton Abbey, you should get into something like that. You can get into some really good binges. Like we talked about Unreal. I would like you guys to go check out Unreal. So expand your knowledge. Get into some of these streaming services. I mean, you're paying $10 a month for it. Might as well use it. But Peaky Blinders, I mean, I've started like, every time I've seen,
I'm going to go. Jesus.
Paying point. Might as well use it, son.
Sorry, Dad. Go out in the yard and watch Netflix. But I mean, like, hell, during Peaky Blinders, I start like shopping online. I'm like, I just type in like Peaky Blinders suits, and I'm like, oh, that's a pretty good price.
He got dressed up for our review. Yeah. He looks good.
Did you put a razor in your cap?
No, I don't. I want to wear the cap to other places. Okay. All
right.
Plus, I don't know where to get how to sew the razor into
disposable
that
disposable razor.
Yeah. But go watch Peaky Blinders. I think it's, and if you Vice on HBO, it may skew a little to the left, and I get that. But it is a very well done docuseries about what's going on in the world. Now, a lot of it is like global warming, we're all going to die, but a lot of it is things that we don't know what's going on. This week was about a heroin epidemic in West Virginia. Who knew that that's the heroin epidemic capital of the world? I had no idea. You know, if you don't read, which I vouch for not reading and watching television, so watch Vice because you learn something. John, if you haven't,
I've been reading my whole life. I don't know. It was a big deal to learn to read when you were younger.
If you could go, if I could have been homeschooled with a television, I probably would have been way smarter and saved.
I mean, this is how I do research for these shows: is reading. So, reading. I mean, you know.
Okay, let's go into the lows. David's pick at one of the lows is Wayward Pine season 2. Donald Glover saying his new series Atlanta will be like Twin Peaks with rap. Baller season 2 trailer. I know we get a little blowback after that. I know this is a bit of an old news, but Uncle Buck, I keep seeing that dumb trailer. And I finally finished Fear the Walking Dead, and that show is not good. I gave it a lot of credit up top. That's what I'll start with. I know it ended a while back, like 2 or 3 weeks ago. I'm finally getting to it because I was putting everything in front of it. I'm like, well, finally, I guess I'll finally finish the season finale. When they said it's the mid-season finale, I was like, there's more of this?
There's 16 episodes this season, yeah.
So, I gave the first couple episodes, and Sinead was making fun of me before we went on, that I gave this, I was like, it's pretty good. It's not bad.
Every week you came in, you had a different opinion on Fear the Walking Dead.
Yeah. Now it's like, I mean, they just shoveled us into some weird situation. I don't get where they're going. I don't know what's happening. It just doesn't make any sense. The show, I feel like the writers were just improvising. It was like the new Fantastic Four movie. They're like, I don't know, this seems like a pretty good idea. You want to blow stuff up now? Cool. Yeah. Like that's Fear the Walking Dead. I'm really, really disappointed by that show. There's so much they could have done with Fear the Walking Dead. There's so much they could have done. And they chose a boat.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. All right. Cool. Yeah. Here's what I'll say. You're totally wrong about Baller season 2. I absolutely love that show. So let's start there. But yeah, Wayward Pines. I don't know how that got a second season.
It did. Well, it got some good views.
Yeah. I don't understand. I tried that. I tried 3 episodes of that. And I was like, I don't know what's going on here. I don't know if Donald Glover, however he wants to say his name, is
Childish Gambino.
Yeah, Childish Gambino.
Let's
right.
Just call it. What
Twin Peaks with rap? Like, do we? What wasn't that called? The Tales from the Hood? Wasn't that what that was? With Clarence Williams III and Snoop Dogg? Didn't we do that? Isn't that what it kind of was? Uncle Buck. I think Josh. I don't know if you said this already because it just kind of all blurred into itself recently. But did you say off camera that you thought like, why even call it Uncle Buck? Yeah. Like, if it's gonna be a situational
Mike
comedy,
Epps is hysterical.
Yeah, just on his own.
And like Blackish is an amazing television
Absolutely.
Show. And it's so well done. And then they're bringing this Uncle Buck thing in, and it's almost like setting you back. You're like, oh great, this stupid show. And I don't care if you made an Asian cast, a black cast, black, white, Asian together. Right. I really don't care. Just don't call it Uncle Buck.
Right.
Because you aren't selling more people on Uncle Buck. Again, it's a nostalgia thing. Uncle Buck was like 1987 or 88, and it was John Candy at his finest. Yeah. And you're going to bring it in 2016 with a black cast about people that nobody who's watching that knows what Uncle Buck is.
Yeah.
You know? It just doesn't make sense to me. These movie adaptations into TV shows, there are some bad ones, and this is just a terrible idea. And ABC, like, let's just cancel another show before it comes on air.
Yeah. You said all I need to say about Uncle Buck. Fear the Walking Dead is another one. If Josh and I, who two of the co-hosts on Walking Dead TV show, can tell you that Fear the Walking Dead is not good,
then you just know that it's not good. Because what you're saying is...
I give shows credit real quick.
You do, but you're saying the same thing, though, that people said about the first season. I felt that way, too. Every week, it was either good or terrible.
Yeah.
So there was no consistency, and that has carried over into the second season, unfortunately, because they've got some good actors. I'm a big fan of Cliff Curtis, Kim Dickens. They're good, good actors.
Kim Dickens in Treme is incredible. Yeah. Kim Dickens in Fear the Walking Dead is the worst.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And Ruben Blades, who I, as a Latino, love to see Ruben Blades whenever he comes on to work. He's so great, so fun, and it's just not working with him.
Griff, let's talk Ballers. You like Ballers. You guys both like Ballers.
Love Ballers.
It's the sports version of Entourage.
Yeah.
See,
and it's The Rock.
It's
The
Rock. Says that.
And the thing is, the lead. The Rock has way more charisma than Adrian Grenier ever had. Adrian Grenier is supposed to be this huge megastar actor that existed in Hollywood, one of the biggest actors and most popular actors in Hollywood. I mean, in his fictional character.
Yeah, right, exactly.
But The Rock embodies everything that you would think from a charismatic big football player. I mean, he's perfect for it.
Me ordering El Pollo Loco has more charisma than Adrian Grenier. Come on.
That's so true.
Fair.
Thanks, Nate. But I was so disappointed by Ballers season one because I wanted it to be more like everybody says it's like Entourage, No, it's about it's the same thing that I hate whenever you divulge into sport, when you dive into sports. First thing they jump into, sports athletes going broke because they pay all their, because it's the same storyline every time, is they come from bad neighborhoods, they support all their buddies, and they go broke because they don't know how to manage their money. And in comes The Rock, who's supposed to be a money manager, and he's also broke. It didn't hit it. Like, if you were going to do Entourage for sports, do it like a mix between Playmakers, which was an amazing show on ESPN, and a little bit more like Entourage. Make it more comedy than this, conflict of, every season of Entourage was the same thing. Is Vince going to do the movie or Vince not going to do the movie? Vince going to do the movie or Vince not going to do the movie? Make it about the struggle of being the actual season and not off-season messing with money.
I see. So your problem with the show was that it didn't focus on the football team more.
Correct.
Oh, okay. Well, this is fascinating. This is interesting. Yeah. Okay, because I enjoyed the premise of the show because we've seen the real-life stories. We haven't really seen the stories on television of these athletes who piss away their money and end up broke and how they come back and the stuff they deal with the women situation, the drug situation, the alcohol situation, pressure from the team, contracts, all that kind of stuff. I thought it was, now that we have so many articles about those kinds of things in the sports world, I thought it was kind of riding the tail, grabbing that tail and riding it and enjoying. And I think they're doing a nice job with the act. I mean, Denzel Washington's son is in this thing. Like, they've cast it really well, and they give legitimate storylines for these actors to confront. Cordry is I'm not always the biggest fan of Rob Cordry. I think he does a nice job in here playing a little more than just the spoiled guy. There's more going on here. And The Rock is really cutting his teeth as an actor on this show.
Sinead, do you watch Ballers?
It's fantastic.
No.
Yeah. I feel like I want to get a female perspective on this because I everybody that likes it, and that my brother's on the fence of liking it with you guys. Mm-hmm. I just wasn't sold. Wasn't interested with the thing, and I wanted to be so involved because I love The Rock. The Rock can do no wrong in my eyes.
Right. What network is that?
HBO.
Okay.
And I want to see, I want to see more of the on-field stuff and what these guys have to go through, because I have a buddy that was in the NFL for 8 years, and the stuff that he talks about with his body, The Rock is going through some stuff. Mm-hmm. It would be way cooler to get into what these guys go in through on a day-to-day basis. Well, a little bit more like a sexier concussion.
Yeah.
That makes sense. Mm-hmm. All right, guys, we're going to do a pilot review today. We watched AMC's Feed the Beast, starring Jim Sturgess and David Schwimmer as a chef and a sommelier, and they're buddies, and there's just a lot going on in this pilot. I'm gonna go to David. David, what do you think of this?
It's serviceable.
Okay.
And pun intended on that.
Very well done.
It's serviceable. It's quaffable, if you want to use a wine drinking term, going to movie sideways right now.
Heavy tones of
show. Yeah. You can drink. I know. I'm sorry. I'm just using the words that I know. Just the words that I know. We talked about Peaky Blinders, their version of the mob. Now we have a guy called the Tooth Fairy.
Yeah.
Really? That's a big mobster? The big Tony Soprano's name's the Tooth Fairy?
The worst, the one thing that pissed
me off. I like
that
actor, though, from Mad Men.
He's great.
That's the one thing I don't want to pick on about the show. I like the performances.
Yeah.
But for me, it looks like Rocha's giving me this weird look.
Let me do it. Let me handle it.
I just don't feel that the story's just not intriguing. It feels like it should be on another network. AMC sets the bar.
Mm-hmm.
They have shows
AMC
takes risks. Walking Dead, for better or for worse, whatever we think of it now, was a risk. Yeah. Successful risk. Mad Men, Breaking Bad. This show is not risky. Yeah. It just feels like the safest show you could possibly make. And that's what bothers me, is that it's safe. Not that it's the worst pod I've ever seen. It's not the worst show on television from one episode. It's just safe. And I think that's what bothers me the most about it.
Okay. if you're a gangster and you're supposed to be like this menacing gangster, Tooth Fairy is a fine name. Whatever you want to do with that.
Okay.
You just don't call yourself the Tooth Fairy. You don't go in and it's like, you know why they call me the Tooth Fairy? No, you shouldn't know why. They can call you the Tooth Fairy. You don't call yourself the Tooth Fairy. I don't go around calling myself Kooks, okay? People call me Kooks because my last name's Macuga. I don't call myself Kooks. That's a nickname that people give you. You are not allowed to call yourself by your nickname, okay? You're not the Tooth Fairy. You're Anton Chekhov or whatever the guy's name was.
Sure.
Okay, Jim Sturgis. Great in
from
across
Star
the
Trek
universe.
Enterprise.
Yeah,
Anton Chekhov.
Yeah, from the Star Trek.
No, I'm just kidding.
Okay, Jim Sturgis. He's like this degenerate kind of thing. I have absolutely no care for this guy at all. Schwimmer, I actually feel really bad for, and I think Schwimmer might be my favorite character on the thing with his son and then the death of his wife. Spoiler alert. But the whole thing.
Too late.
Too late. We missed it. Sorry, Ann.
Too late.
They say it like the first. You don't actually see his wife alive and then dead. She's dead when the show starts.
Well, you have ruined the entire show.
Why even watch it?
You got the whole story. Why watch it?
But it's the show just like doesn't have anything that I'm like, God, I really hope they get the restaurant going so he can pay back a mobster. Ooh wee. Like it's just kind of decent.
Yeah.
What's up, T-Bone? They said that like 10 times.
Like you say T-Bone. It was ridiculous. T-Bone.
T-Bone. It's a meat reference because I'm a chef. Get it? Yeah.
Like, there's a lot of this show that I really didn't like. Oh, I'm sorry. Did you want to finish?
It was a Seinfeld Costanza moment. Yeah. I'm T-Bone. You are Coco the monkey. Like,
to me, it was really, it was a tough watch because I expected more from AMC. Mm. This felt very much like that Mark Strong show that they had for one season.
Low Winter Sun.
Yeah, Low Winter
Don't
Sun.
Dog which, the Low Winter Sun.
Well, that was a really hard show to get into.
Yeah,
but this is the opposite of that. Whereas that show was really dense with a lot of politics going on.
It went for something. Yes. It didn't work, but it went for it.
This is the opposite of that, where I felt like it was TV by numbers.
Yeah.
Let's all set it in New York. Everyone's white. The gangster is white. Everyone's white, and then they have a kid half
and it's
white
in the Bronx,
half black. Right, it's in the Bronx. Teacher Latina, great, possibly, but that scene with the teacher, terrible.
Yeah,
she's overplaying everything. Yeah, he has liquor on his breath because he's a sommelier. That's not a negative.
Yeah.
He is a sommelier, so he has a taste. He just signed the thing with the guy who was only going to take four cases. That scene was terrible. The scene with the woman at the grief anonymous or whatever.
She's hot.
She's just going to walk up to him, start a conversation with him, and then hey, I can solve your problems. We're looking for wine.
Yeah.
And then
we should exchange numbers.
Yeah, we should exchange numbers.
And the fact that she was smiling during that dramatic conversation. Yeah, she was like, well, you can tell, like, oh, this is going to be a future romantic relationship.
Of course. And
I'm
then,
like,
exactly.
David, not the right time. Not the right time.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. The paint by numbers. Right. You saw the beats coming, and that's the problem. And then when they, you know, in that meeting, the counselor selects her to be the woman that he tells his feelings about his wife to, so they can solidify their relationship without going farther, without having dates. Like, already right there, she's already attracted to him, just the way his vulnerability. And they don't do enough. That's what I felt. They candid you stuff, and they didn't do enough of like really solidifying the stuff. I get that
I think AMC knew what they had their hands, because they debuted it after Preacher.
Yeah,
they're putting two more episodes tomorrow night.
Yeah,
on Tuesday, and then they're just gonna try and jam them down our throat until it's over. Because I mean, I'm gonna give it three episodes if I'm not like unhating it. I have to give everything.
Yeah, fair. You're a good guy.
If I'm just like, I'm over it, then I'll just watch some old Friends episodes with Sinéad and we'll, you know, remember the good old days of Ross Geller.
But didn't it feel like every scene was a setup so that he could cook something?
Yep.
Every scene was just like, let's talk about crazy stuff. Hey, let's make something. You know,
especially if you watch something like Preacher.
Yeah.
And then you go in to watch. Not that the show needs to be Preacher, over the top violence and craziness, but it just, again, risks.
Yeah.
AMC is one of those, again, like HBO Leftovers, first season.
Right.
Not a great first season. But again, it went for something. It wasn't something I had seen every day on TV. But when I watched this, I'm like, oh, I could see this on ABC, you know, something like that.
Nothing,
I just felt too safe.
Nothing says a guy I want to root for, like a degenerate cokehead who gets out of jail and the first thing he does is do more coke.
And sleep with his lawyer.
Yeah, awesome.
Who's from Spartacus, by the way, Cummings.
And,
she's a good actress.
And, Jim Sturgis is supposed to be this, like, whatever.
Yeah. Yeah. Sturgis is a good actor. I like him
Pilot
across
review,
the universe.
Review fail.
Yeah, this is not something I recommend you guys go out and watch right away.
Basically, you guys all hate it.
Yeah.
The
so beast, go check it out. Yeah. Go watch it. Yeah.
The beast that we fed was our consciousness. It's not good. All right. Let's go into some Twitter questions, guys. Hashtag a Collider TV Talk. You guys have been sending in some awesome, awesome questions. We love them. Keep sending them. We really, really appreciate it. And we love all you guys for watching the show. So, Sinéad, what's first in Twitter questions.
All right. Iran Kihano tweets, what are some of the most emotional moments on TV for you? For me, Fresh Prince when he confronts his dad.
Oh, man, that's a good one.
That was. It was somebody made a great meme of that with Kevin Durant as Will Smith and OKC. Oh, no. Kevin Durant as, what would he be? As the dad and OKC as Will Smith. I didn't need you. It was brilliant. It was good.
For me, I think when at the end of Breaking Bad, when in the finale, spoiler alert, do we want to throw that up? Like
what?
Breaking Bad. I'm just saying. We're gonna ruin when Walter comes back to.
That's real nice of you.
He comes back to Albuquerque and he sees Walt Jr. getting off the bus in this like crappy little like condo area of Albuquerque. It's so depressing, and he's hiding behind the building, and he sees what he's done to his family, especially his son, which is what he wanted to do from the set out, is just like make sure his family was okay, and in turn he left his family, you know, in hell. That if you don't cry a little bit at that point, something wrong with you. And maybe my other one that I always like get a little emotional in is the like season or series finales when they're like clean and they move out, like the end of Friends when you see the frame on the door, or at the end of Growing Pains and they see the family picture.
And then he tells what happened to each of them.
Yeah, it's there's something about those ones that leave you crying at the end of a series that did their job.
David, I love the Parks and Recreation finale.
Oh, man.
I thought Parks and Rec was such a good show. One of my favorite. I'm not a big comedy guy. I don't watch a lot of comedies. So that's definitely my weak point on TV talk. So when I do see a good comedy that I like, I really get into it. And I love Parks and Rec. And that finale just ended perfectly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I love that.
Sinead?
Well, Friends is a great one. Yeah. Part one and part two.
Yeah.
Part one is Ross when he confronts her at the airport.
Yeah.
She says she won't stay. And then part two, obviously, is the best. I think the first time I remember getting emotional was I was a kid watching Full House, and it was when Papuli died.
Oh, Papuli.
I cried like a little bitch when Papuli died. And Michelle is like on the boat,
because
they have the boat in the backyard, and she like ditches school because Papuli was supposed to come teach her class a dance, so she ditches school and she's hiding on the boat, and then Uncle Jesse goes out there. I mean, I was like the Grinch. I was like, what are these things I'm feeling inside? That was the first time I think I remember having real emotion.
Yeah.
I got a few, because I've been watching TV for almost 30 years. For me, the number one is always going to be Bobby Simone's death on NYPD Blue.
Yeah, that's tough.
Spoiler alert.
1998. Oh, there we go.
1998.
Someone's like, I'm going through a binge right now.
That was they dragged that over two episodes, and the final, everyone coming into his room, Sipowicz dealing with his death, Kim Delaney dealing with his, Diane Russell, all those things that were just really great, powerful moments for all the cast to walk up to him and say goodbye to him, and it almost mirrored real life because he was leaving the show, right? It was so powerful. I think one of the best episodes of TV ever done with this very emotional, I cry every time I see it. It's a Doctor Who episode where they go back and Amy Pond is such a huge fan of Vincent Van Gogh, and so they go back and explore his suicide. Mm. And I'm getting emotional even talking about it, because like people, if you've had someone who's had that or you've experienced that or had those feelings about it, you understand. And she loves him so much that she thinks she can save him. And even when they bring him to the future, spoiler, and he sees how everyone reveres his paintings, he still kills himself. And when Amy finds out, she is just devastated, and you're devastated for her because you experience her love for Vincent Van Gogh's paintings through her performance, through Gillian Films before. And then so when the doctor tells her, because she thinks like, let's go visit him and see where he's at 80 years old, and the doctor's like, he still killed himself. Yeah. She's just broken in that. Oh. And I would say another one was Daryl killing Merle as a zombie in Walking Dead. Mm. What a powerful moment. And one of the most moving ones is if you've ever seen All in the Family, if you go back and watch old television, when Edith dies and Archie Bunker is in their bedroom, and he has her like slipper that they had, he took everything out of her room, and then he found the slipper under the bed, the white slipper, and he's there and he's talking to her. And you just break apart. If you've ever lost someone like that, you just break apart.
There's obviously you can say things like the Red Wedding, because whole family was killed.
Yeah.
There in Sopranos, when she actually dies, the actress dies in real life of cancer, Tony's mother.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of season three, like the first parts of season three, they're using hologram technology and writing her into parts of lines that she's already said on the show, which is unbelievably well done as far as TV goes. But his mom dies and Tony watches Public Enemy.
Right.
And he is Public Enemy, and it's a really like life imitating art kind of a thing. And it's so hard when you think about like the things that you could have done to be nicer to your mother.
Yeah.
And like, you just want to call your mom after that and be like, "Mom, you know, I'm sorry that I like burned the house down when I was 3. That's what? You know, no, like, I mean, I lit part of our house on fire when I was younger on accident. Wow. Anyway, that's another story for another day, guys. It's just don't leave bagels in the oven and fall asleep. Okay.
How long were you?
Where everybody's fine, there's a lot of smoke.
How were you putting bagels in the oven at 3 years old?
I was a precocious kid.
You really were. Yeah.
He's like, "I could really go for a bagel right now."
I was like trending to 4.
Scratching his beard like.
I was shaving pretty young there, Sinead. All right, what's next?
All right, Peter tweets, "What are your favorite reality TV shows? Mine are Face Off and Ninja Warrior. Japanese is better than American."
Man vs. Food, hands down. If that's, I mean, I think when people say reality show, anything that isn't scripted, I'll just throw in reality. Like, I'm not going to say Keeping Up with the Kardashians or something dumb like that. But like, I love Man vs. Food. The fact that the guy ate so much food that he couldn't do the show anymore, that's sacrificing yourself for your art right there. I love that.
And then had to lose like all that weight so he could live.
Yes. Yeah. David?
I like the cooking shows, Top Chef, Master Chef on Fox. I like cooking, so I enjoy those shows.
Last week, Sinead and Sasha were talking during The Bachelor, and Adam, in his just perfection of running the show, cut to David in my space, just like,
lean back, get comfortable.
Sinead, you love reality TV.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, tonight there is a new episode of The Bachelorette. I love The Bachelorette. I love reality TV. I love Cutthroat Kitchen.
Oh, good.
I can really get down with some Cutthroat Kitchen like 12 hours later on Netflix. Mm-hmm. I love that those stupid reality shows. I like Keeping Up with the Kardashians. I like Below Deck. It's about like a bunch of people who work on cruise ships, really? Charters, yachts. And they all fall in love with each other and they hook up and they have crazy clients. All the Real Housewives, dig those. I mean, I love it all. I'll watch anything.
Sinead is the best.
What's the Project Runway is fantastic. Mm-hmm. For a guy who's not into fashion in any way, shape, or form, it's an engrossing show. I love that show. A lot of stuff on the cooking channels. My ex-girlfriend got me into the cooking stuff, and I started watching these shows, and I was like,
addicting.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. Like Diners, Drive-Ins, and I will spend 4 hours on a Friday night if I got nothing to do, and I will go through the whole thing. Yeah. Chopped is stressful as hell.
Yeah.
I don't want to reveal too much, but I was all for an evening with some friends, and we watched Chopped, and I was never more stressed out in my entire life, as if my life was on the line for these poor people who were trying to win $10,000 cooking these things and rushing around. Ooh. I'm like, I don't even know how you do that.
Iron Chef was a great one too. Yeah. Kitchen Stadium classic.
Oh yeah, Iron Chef, and the great food trucks, right? Which is a little guilty pleasure of mine.
Mm-hmm. Let's do one more. Sinead.
Elite Gunner 9 tweets, "Which show made you talk like one of the characters? I've been yelling by order of the Peaky Effing Blinders."
When Peaky Blinders is on, I jump right into Arthur, you know, and he's the best. He's got that raspy voice. I've said Peaky Blinders a billion times in the show. When Sopranos was on, I started talking in that Jersey accent a little bit. Yeah. Tony.
Yes. The Gabagool.
Yeah. Satriels. let me think on this for a second. I've got a couple more. David, go ahead.
Oh, I'd probably go with, oh man.
You know what I say a ton? I say Ragnar Lothbrok all the time.
Yeah, Vikings is addicting. Yeah, that's because their accent's so interesting that I don't try to mimic that Scandinavian style, but it's really cool. Game of Thrones.
Yeah.
You know, I love doing all like Jon Snow, of course. Well, Jon Snow. Jon Snow. You know, it's like dark. I'm horrible at impressions.
You know nothing, Jon Snow?
Yeah.
To me.
Shut up, Sinead.
To me, that was great. That was amazing. Thanks, man. That's good. I think Keanu did better in Dracula.
But that's the last time he gets invited.
Oh, no. I would say Tony Soprano, absolutely. That's the number one guy. I would see those shows, and I just have always been a fan of Italian mafia stuff. So to see the way he spoke, the way he spoke,
that's a real word.
And then you would get off the phone, you would get off, and you'd be like, "Oh, what's up?" And the Boardwalk Empire is another one.
Oh yeah,
Boardwalk Empire, just the way they spoke at those times, the precision of their words and the construction of their sentences was fantastic to listen to and get influenced by.
It's a who house.
Sinead's been texting like Gossip Girl for years, so we know that.
It's true. Yeah. They actually based that entire show on me.
XOXO, Sinead. Okay, Twitter questions, guys. Thank you for sending them in. Again, hashtag Unclattered TV Talk. You guys send some of the best questions in the biz, so thank you. David, pick of the week.
Oh, these are always so much fun. It's always just like you're trying to talk about a whole show in like under a minute, you know? It's like this should be a game show doing this, yeah. But we're going to talk about Rome today. This is on HBO. It's one of my favorite shows of all time, canceled before, you know, it needed to be two seasons. And what's interesting is this actually paved the way for Game of Thrones on mm-hmm. HBO, one of the biggest television productions in the history of TV, co-produced with, I believe, BBC and HBO for over, like, they're spending over, like, $100 to $115 million
they
per season.
They built a whole city of Rome outside of Rome.
It's yeah. gorgeous. Some excellent performances. I was a history major in undergrad, and we would always talk about doing history from, you know, the bottom up and the top down. Rome covers all those areas. So you get these two characters. The most interesting characters are Titus Pullo and Lucius Vorenus, who was played by Kevin McKidd, and Titus Pullo was played by Ray Stevenson. And mm-hmm. you get perspectives from there. I guess they would be considered the average everyday people, even though they were put in extraordinary circumstances. You'd get the views from Julius Caesar in season one and the ruling family, some great strong female characters in this, great battles, and it's so soapy and rich. You have Edmure Tully from Game of Thrones, mm-hmm. played by Tobias Menzies, who's also an Outlander, played Brutus mm-hmm. on this series. And I mean, everything was so good. It was canceled, you know, before its time, and it's too bad. Yeah. You know, it's too bad because it yeah. was such a good series. It did pave the way. We talked to Dennis about the show all the time because I think HBO realized that they're actually making money off this show and they didn't need to cancel it. Right. So season two, if it feels a little bit rushed, there's a reason for that.
Yeah. But also too is because the reason that Game of Thrones first season didn't get as big as budget as obviously mm-hmm. it's getting now is because they had a little bit of the Rome worry.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Is that they built this thing and it didn't have like the cult following that a couple of their other ones did. But if you're a Rome fan, then you know, like David and myself, again, I love Roman history. So to go and watch Rome again, I've watched the series
still
two times
good.
Through.
Oh, yeah. It was back in, 2004, 2005. Yeah. It still looks good.
Yeah, and a lot of those actors do show up in Game of Thrones. Yeah. Mm-hmm. The British Indian actress, I think her name is the one who's in Dorne.
Oh, yeah, India. Yeah,
what happens with her and Kevin McKidd in the show mm-hmm. in first season. That's such a shocking moment in that first season. Kevin McKidd is fantastic. And then I always think
he's been hiding on Grey's Anatomy for a while, but he's doing well. He's working.
Well, he had that Journeyman show, which I loved on NBC, mm-hmm. but not a lot of people watched mm-hmm. it, and it would have been with Moon Bloodgood, and it could have been fantastic if people got. So Rome is so good. You're right. The production value, the storylines. And you're right, because they found out halfway through the making of season two they were going to get canceled.
Yeah.
That's why it's rushed.
Yeah. If you think Game of Thrones has a lot of boobs,
yeah.
Watch this. All right. This goes
just as much syphilis too. Yeah. Okay, guys, that is it for us here on Collider TV Talk. Before we go out of here, Sinead, where can the lovely people find you?
I'm online at Sinead DeFries. I'm here on Mondays for TV Talk and on Fridays for Movie Talk and over the weekend for a mailbag. And you can find me at thatsosinead.com.
David Griffin.
I want to live where Sinead lives online. Like, their photos, everything. Her world is just seems fabulous.
Aw, yeah, that's fabulous. So nice.
Yeah, it seems fabulous. I, on the other hand, am, you know, doing all right. You can find me on Twitter at GriffinDE, as well as, we covered a lot of stuff this week.
Doing all right.
We did Preacher. We did Peaky Blinders. Yeah. We did Voltron interview. I'm around. I'm hanging in there, man. I'm surviving.
He's crushing it. It's a big towering five iron. John Rocha.
Yeah, in no way can I follow either of these two. That's fantastic. Guys, always find me at The Rocha Says on Twitter and Instagram. You see all the shows I'm hosting, all the shows I get to be a guest on like this, which I'm always happy to come on. Thank you so much, guys, for having me. It was such a fun time.
John Rocha, thank you for being here. Appreciate it. Great insight, as always. Guys, thank you for watching. You guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Josh Macuga. My YouTube channel, The Josh Macuga Show. Every Monday, we're here on Collider TV. Collider Movie Talk? Collider TV Talk. Hashtag at Collider TV Talk. We love you guys for watching. From the whole crew, we all agree, put down the book, pick up the remote.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.